So don't worry, my talk is not for 30 minutes. I guess we can really make it in time. And before I'm coming to the UFOs, I just would like to make a few comments on innovations. We launched in February this year the first anti-Zika ELISA, which is a hot topic in Brazil, of course. We launched in recent months some other assays for neuropathies. And I was asked, what about the management of innovations at Euroimmun? And I had absolutely no idea what the management of innovation is. So I looked it up. What is an innovation? An innovation would be a device which really works. So it's not true when I said my talk is not going for 30 minutes. It will go for 30 minutes. So just a brief definition. There's an idea or an invention, and it's only an innovation if there's an economic implementation. So there are ideas, but we really have to bring it to reality. What are the main obstacles in innovation management, in really getting innovations? And this is shown in the next cartoons. I guess it really needs an environment of open discussions. And like this gentleman here, we should not do it because we never did it before is not really a good argument. And also, innovation needs space, it needs creativity. And it should be, and this is true for companies as well as for academic institutions. If someone is buried with daily work, you cannot be innovative. These two gentlemen are just too busy to see a potential use of a wheel. So it needs time for new ideas. This is a classical model of innovation. Usually we are working together with scientific institution, academy, there's biomarker identification, patents, then transfer to the industry, different companies, we develop assays and launch it to the market. At Euroimmun, we try to do more vertical integration. So we established a number of different infrastructures, molecular biology, biochemistry, different assay developments, reference laboratory, patent attorneys are also in the company, so we try to accelerate that process. What are the possibilities we have? We have assay technologies, immunofluorescence, recombinant cell-based assays, ELISA, blot, radioimmunoassays are still done, molecular diagnostics, array technology, so we can play around different technologies. We have biochemistry, purification, identification of target antigens. At our facilities, we have mass spectrometry, so we don't have to go to a university. We can just do it immediately in-house. Molecular biology has established the expression of recombinant antigens from E. coli, yeast, baculovirus, to mammalian cells. They can design antigens, so it's like toys for them. They can play with it like Lego toys. It's really funny to see. So the developers of assays, every week we get new target antigens. We have a reference laboratory as a source of samples, and as I mentioned, also our patent department is quite important to assess immediately freedom to operate. I'd like to talk about this anti-flotiline now, a marker, a new marker for neuropathies, and how we identify this new marker. So these are several methods for the discovery of new target antigens, which are quite established, used worldwide. It's Western blot, radioimmunoprecipitation, immunoprecipitation with labeled toxins, expression libraries, protein or peptide libraries. All that is used, and every technology may lead to the identification of a new target. So we can copy it, but we thought, what are the unique sources of Euroimmun? Is there any way which is not done maybe by other route, which could be successful? So we started the UFO project. What is an UFO? It's an unknown fluorescence object. So we start with our immunofluorescence technology. We see reactivity, there is a pattern, but afterwards in monospecific assays, there is no established autoantigen. We cannot find a target. So then we screen for these the patterns, whether we find something else, any hint. If this is not the case, then we start the UFO project. Everything starts with immunofluorescence slides, and we are also using the immunofluorescence slides to identify the targets in the way we are doing it I'm talking about. So it's from immunofluorescence to histoimmunoprecipitation. This is the technology we are using. This is the incubation scheme of immunofluorescence, sample incubation on a cryosection, removal of unbound antibodies by washing, incubation of reporter conjugate anti-human IgG, FITC, so we see a label and that can be seen in fluorescence microscopy. And then we are changing it. We are using the same sample incubation on a cryosection, removal of unbound antibodies by washing steps, but then we extract the immune complexes which are on the tissues from the slides, pull down the immune complexes with magnetic beads, and analyze this immune complex by mass spectrometry. This is our approach. Acquisition of samples is our own laboratory, but we are now more and more working international with other groups. Our own laboratory handles around 200 to 300 samples per day for neurology-related requests. We are mainly looking for serum. Stratification is, there is a certain pattern, but we do not have a target. We focus on IgG, we need a high titer, should be above 1 in 100. We need a certain volume, minimum is 200 microliter of serum to do all these analysis and identifying a target. And now one example, this is Flotiline 1 and Flotiline 2. What was done? This is an index patient showing staining on the outer molecular layer in the cerebellum. So we had this pattern, controlled serum is negative. This is an UFO, unknown fluorescence object. We had no idea about the target. We pulled it down, we extracted it, and then made a Western blot analysis here on the left side, Komasi stain. The strong bands here, these are light, heavy and light chains of IgG because it's an immunocomplex. But additionally, we found this very faint band here. This was only seen with the index patient. Control patients had no band here. So we already had a marker on a molecular level. Then we identified it by fingerprint mass spectrometry verification, and we found that this band is related to Flotiline 1 and 2. Both are 50 kilodalton proteins. They are highly highly expressed in adult brain, spinal cord, heterocomplexes, and even the role of these proteins is known. They play a role in the optic nerve regeneration. We bought commercial antibodies against Flotiline 1 and 2 and stained the immunoblot with the bought antibodies. That was a false confirmation. The commercially available anti-flotidine, very intense stain, this faint band here, anti-flotidine 1, control antibody, anti-flotidine 2, control antibody. First verification that we really picked up the right target antigen. Then we did double immunofluorescence. Patient samples, commercially available anti-flotidine 2 antibody, we merge it, and we see this is a perfect match, so it's really co-localization. Then we established recombinant cell-based assays. We overexpressed Flotiline 1 in cells, Flotiline 2 in cells, a combination of both, and mock transfected cells. And this is always a control sample. Quite surprisingly, in the natural environment, could not see any signal. So obviously we need the hetero, or the dimer of Flotiline 1 and 2. We need the complex. Only by expressing both Flotiline proteins, we could see a signal. Then, that was the last experiment, also neutralization assays. We incubated the serum, the index patient, with a control extract, and there was no neutralization. And then we incubated the index patient with a Flotiline 1 and 2 extract, and there was neutralization. That was the final proof that we're really talking about autoantibodies against Flotiline 1 and Flotiline 2. So we had in our laboratory 7 patients with that pattern, all 7 patients reacted with a recombinant cell-based assay on the DMARD of Flotigin 1 and 2, and that was really interesting. Every individual patient had multiple sclerosis. That was the first sign that we found a marker for multiple sclerosis. The question now was, what is the prevalence in multiple sclerosis? So we checked 500 patients for anti-flotilin antibodies, and that was a bit disappointing for us because only 7 patients were positive. So the prevalence found in multiple sclerosis is just 1.4%. But interestingly enough, all the antibodies seem to be related to a phenotype between multiple sclerosis and neuromyelitis optica, and now more and more studies are ongoing worldwide to see the significance of these antibodies. But it was just an example that our way to pull down, to extract immunoprecipitate, immune complexes from tissues is really working, and we identified this new marker. Identification since 2013, we are heavily working on that. So far, 17 new target antigens in neuropathies. All are related to neuropathies. What we do not know, do they really have clinical significance? In some cases, so I don't want to read all the lists, it's also too complicated, all these funny names. This is another list of other markers. It may be the case that this is just a case report, just one patient shows a certain pattern, and this is a target antigen. Or we may find really a relevant marker with a high prevalence. We discussed it heavily also with Joseph Dalmau, who found out NMDA receptor antibodies. In the beginning, it was also just one patient. Then he found a few more patients, and now it's an established marker. And this is exactly what we are doing on these 17 new markers. What is also important, this is not only working in neuropathies. It can also work in any other disease. Whenever there is an unknown fluorescence staining, we can try to identify the target. We just started a project with another group in the United States on ANA pattern. There's an ANA, but none of the known target antigens is positive, and we already identified within the last 2-3 months 3 new markers, new proteins in the cell nuclei, and now we are checking the prevalence of these markers. It could be done for kidney diseases, it can be done for any disease, and we are just encouraging everyone, if you are interested in such a project, you have clinically characterized patients, you are aware of unknown fluorescence patterns, please let us know if you like, we can work on that and publish on that together. Just some examples of scientists or entrepreneurs where they were wrong. There's an idea, it's implemented, but it's not always recognized as an innovation. Louis Pasteur's theory of germs is ridiculous fiction. We know it better now. I think there's a world market for maybe 5 computers. I guess in every bag there are more than 5 computers nowadays. Who would actually need the silver disk? In 82, Jan Timmermann from Philips, 20 years later, everyone used it, but he's right. Nowadays, no one is using silver disk. It already disappeared. And also an example where an entrepreneur was right. If I had asked my customers what they wanted, they would have said a faster horse. Thanks that you worked on the cars. Thank you very much for your attention.